So, we would like to continue with the last talk of this session. Dennis Baustus from Geolytix will present composing and securing spatial data interfaces. When, why, how? Serverless edition.
Hello, thank you very much. So the title was already read out. I want to start with a little disclaimer. Hang on. Serverless, it uses servers. Of course it does, so that would be way too long. But when I talk serverless, I mean function as a service or cloud edition, have it running in a cloud. And the why I take at the beginning, charge only for what you use, have require zero server maintenance, provide continuous scaling, and support built-in high availability and fault tolerance. So with high availability, I mean not just it is always available, but it's also quickly available. So it's a web service. You don't want to wait a second or 2 seconds for a module to boot up or to be available from a cold start. So that's the why, and I'm going to now continue with the presentation how to do this, because the when is now. We're already doing it. We is Geolytix, where I work, and Geolytix is a location planning expert. We are a consultancy firm. We mainly do data, which is fantastic because we don't sell software, so literally every software we write is open source completely. And that's the reason why I joined them. I worked before in proprietary software, and I really only want to do open source. And I go to every Phosphor-G event since I joined Geolytix, mainly because they pay for it. They're really open about open source, and they support it, and yeah, they fund it. We have a couple of offices around the world. We actually open a new office in Sydney, I think, this month, so I gotta have to I need to update the map and move the whole bit a bit higher. As I said, we do location intelligence. So location intelligence involves layering locations and doing some analysis. Unfortunately, we don't really have a good marketing department. That's why I used a little graphic from Geoblink. Why? Because I really like what Geoblink are doing. And there are other companies out there. So ourselves, location, 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 that's what we do. We capture locations, we analyze locations, and report them. So with the capturing, I mean, we're not going out there and survey locations. Capturing is just, it's data collection. So that means we use a lot of open source data, like OpenStreetMap and other available sources, like data for good from Facebook, population densities, a lot of census data. And we mesh it up with client data. So a client has like their private data, which obviously is sensitive, and we mesh it up with the open data and provide a secure interface to the data. And that interface is used to analyze the data, meaning you can run models and return the models as a report, which can be either a map or a printed map, or can literally just be text. So what's the location? Location make up the spatial data. That's the core unit. It doesn't matter whether it's a raster, and a raster location is a grid cell, or whether it's a store, whether it's a country, a polygon. In a purest form, a location has one or more geometries. So in this case, the location has only a coordinate, latitude, longitude, and it's a store. The only property it has, it's a category. In this case, it's a Marks and Sparks store. The reason I choose this, because we do a lot of retail, and we have this retail points free data set where we just have for the UK all retail locations. Obviously, there are a lot more properties, but as I said, if we do work for the retailer, it's sensitive information, and that's what we talk later about, because it's sensitive, it has to be secure. What are the spatial data interfaces? Well, mainly they're the views. The views is what you look at the data. So the most popular one is the map, but a table is also a spatial data interface view, because it is basically the same. In this case, it is the same information which is shown on the map. I only don't list the coordinates in the table view, but show the map with a clustering algorithm. So where there's a lot more stores in the table, these are mostly in this dark grayish dot where they're clustered up. The cluster algorithm we wrote ourselves as well, and it's all part of this whole package. The methods of the spatial data interfaces is how we interact with the data. So we have the table or the map to look at it, and by adding interaction to these interfaces, for example, we want to digitize on a map, or we want to open a location view or a table view and just override the information, just go into a field and change the information. And those methods is basically the CRUD methods: create, read, update, delete. And that's really great for the cloud, because for a RESTful API, because what we have is the put, get, delete, and they really translate well to SQL, because all of our data is stored in a relational database, Postgres, SQL. So this is like the breakdown of this whole spatial data interface. So the backend is where the data is at rest. So data at rest is one part. The other part is a workspace. A workspace is the configuration of the data. So that means like, how should the data be styled? What are the property fields? So it's not very standardized, but we're trying to look at other standards which are out there and implement them. The ACL is the access control list. That's basically the roles, the profiles where you log in. So it's all in Postgres. Also caching, MVTs, everything happens in Postgres. We don't use GeoServer or Map Server or anything with it. Everything we do either directly in the database or we do in the middleware. And the middleware is a Node.js middleware, which is basically a RESTful API. So that means there are either methods which can be called and return, or there are static files. So static files could be resources like an SVG pin, or even a template. The HTM template for a view is a static file which is merged, and the libraries are static files. So the library is downloaded, or you can import it, and talks to the middleware on an endpoint. The workspace also exists in the middleware. So the workspace is set as a JSON file in the backend, and in the middleware, it's memorized in the process. And on the client, the workspace exists as well, where it's retrieved from the middleware and might be redacted due to roles. We talk about this a bit later. And obviously, there's a lot of other third-party services out there, which either the front-end can directly talk to or going through a proxy. In our case, for a proxy, so our clients, they're not Mapbox clients or they're not Google Maps clients, but we are. So that means we have the key, and the key is stored in the environment. And if the front-end talks to the middleware, then the key is added in proxy to retrieve the data, a tile or an ISO line, and is sent to the front end. So that is all possible through the REST interface, the 2616. So we are big fans of that. I'm especially because before I worked with SOAP and built ASP.NET applications. And for those of you who know, it's not fun. Neither SOAP nor ASP.NET. So the front end, that's the library, which is hosted by the middleware, and it's objects and views and dashboards. So the dashboard is basically many views. So you can have a map or table on the dashboard, and an object is what's behind the view. So a layer or location is an object. Multiple locations make up a layer, multiple layers can make up a map, and so on and so forth. The backend, obviously Postgres. PostGIS, extended Postgres, wouldn't really make sense to use anything else for vector data. So that used to be the bottleneck. Not so much for us, because our clients, it's not really public applications what we do, although we go into the market of public applications, but it's a client who has like 10 or 20 users at the same time. So we just use a DigitalOcean droplet on which we have Postgres running, and we don't really have to scale. In our case, we scale, we add more block storage, but we don't have the problems that the process is slow. However, geographical replication is an issue, especially for our clients in China, which have to go through a VPN, and backups are really hard because added to the sensitive data. We don't really want to roll a different Postgres cluster for every client, so we need to make sure how we do the backups and that the data, the client data, doesn't get mixed up. Nowadays, it's a lot easier because Amazon Aurora is there. So Amazon Aurora is, it's not Postgres. I think Paul Ramsey wrote an article recently, make Jeff richer, basically. They use Postgres algorithms, but Aurora itself is a fork. However, what Aurora does really well, it scales really well. So you have all your data, the stored data, which just sits somewhere in the Amazon cloud, and there's a warm pool of database capacity. So that means if you do a request, an instance warms up, or a warm instance is used and processes this. And this instance stays alive, I think, for 3 minutes or 4 minutes. So all the subsequent requests are really, really quick. And the proxy fleet in between, that's like the data API. That makes sure that you don't have long delays. And as Amazon say, it's really easy to use. It's not. Same as the simple notification service. I only call it notification service because it's really not simple, but it's necessary. In this case, I want to say later today, there's here XYZ talk. I'm really looking forward to this because I wasn't aware of the PostGIS, Postgres, Aurora until Oliver sent me an email and said, that's what we're using, and I read up on it, and it's really great. So I need to learn that myself as well. So going to the middleware, that's like kind of like my really favorite part, because I'm really a proponent of everything that can be written in JavaScript will eventually be written in JavaScript. So that's why I never really got into GeoServer, because it's Java. And mainly the JavaScript, the Node.js has this, the middleware pattern, the middleware onion, which is really perfect for writing any form of REST API. So it means that certain layers, one layer could be the security layer, another layer might be a caching layer, another layer might be a process. Well, the processing is the handler, that's right in the middle, the core. But there might be several processing layers through which a request goes. So this whole middleware onion can be a Lambda. So a Lambda is it's an anonymous function. It can be anything, a Lambda. And in our case, the Lambda is a Fastify process. That means the whole process with HTTP server and router, that's Fastify, is one process which we put in the cloud, and it scales. In our case, we use SiteNow, because SiteNow has long-running processes. That means we say this process is always on, so there's no cold start problem. And it's all middleware. So the Fastify router has like all the handlers, which are endpoints, and they're shared modules. The shared modules are the layers of the middleware onion through which the request goes. The environment settings, that's the process environment. So as I said, every process needs to have some, you don't need to read so much, it's they're obviously all randomly generated passwords, so you don't need to take notes. So these are the keys, for example, for Google here, or Mapbox, or the Ordnance Survey, as well as our own databases and which workspace to use, and they are all on the process. So obviously every process needs these environment settings, and they have to be completely separated to the workspace, although a workspace needs to reference them, because in a workspace I might say, create me an isoline using the here service, and then it takes the key, or I want to have a backdrop from the Ordnance Survey Zoom stack. So again, I use the key OS, and that proxies and gets me the backcloth. As I said, the workspace builds upon the environment, and in the back end, it's just one huge JSON object. So on the side, it's a request. Every instance has this workspace. So if I just say on the endpoint workspace get, it gets me this whole object. And it's like split down into locales, which are like either a country, or it's just like a spatial separation. And you can have many locales in a workspace, and the locale can have many layers, and obviously a layer can have many locations. And so that builds up as the definition of a deployment, the definition of a project. So I go now through an anatomy of a request, which is the request as it comes in and goes out to the middleware onion. So this is actually a real request where we say, get me a location. I want to select the location by an ID. And I know this location is on in a table, on a layer, on a locale. The table and layer is different because a layer can have different tables. For example, layers with complex geometries. If you are at a higher zoom level, there's a layer where the geometry is a lot more complex than when you're further zoomed out. Also, we might want to apply different clustering algorithms depending on which zoom level you have. And importantly, the token, because it's sessionless. It's all the information is in that token. And again, you don't need to make a note because all of our tokens expire after 8 hours. And I think I created this one a few days ago. So all what the token tells me is who I am and which rights I have. Am I an administrative user? May I be an administrator for other users? Or may I be able to modify the workspace? And do I have specific roles which may apply to a workspace? So the first step is obviously, is the token good? If the token is bad, then you will thrown out straight away. Then the query parameters, the table, layer, ID, are these all valid inputs? And then thereafter I check the roles. So if I go to a layer or a location which has certain roles applied, it checks, do I have the roles? Am I allowed to see that layer? Am I allowed to edit this location? If I can't, then you get the message insufficient privileges. And thereafter, all what's left to do is the handler. So in this handler, it's a stored SQL query. In this case, it's a very simple query, but it can be also a complex query. It can be a model, which is either a stored procedure or it's stored in the middleware. And that's why it's secure. I never sent a SQL request from the client to the middleware. All the SQL requests are stored in the middleware and they're only referenced. So and in this case, I know it's the select. But in other cases, I can say, please run this really complex query which is stored under this reference and has certain roles applied. So the query has roles applied. And in the end, we used an Node.pg, so we only put the ID in an array, so it's all battle tested and there's no problem with SQL injections. In fact, if I would put SQL into Node.pg, they would already look for SQL injections. So it's a two-tiered security. First, is that query in the workspace or as a stored procedure? And second, do never send SQL, just send the IDs and merge them together. And when it's all done, I get the GeoJSON as a, the GeoJSON as a response in this case. But the response could be in other forms. So the next bit is going to microservices. So as I said before, the Fastify process is one service, a long-running service. But in the future, we want to have that every handler is its own microservice. So the problem with that is the middleware. The middleware onion doesn't really work that well with microservices, and we need to find some form of database connections which are defined by the environment, that they are available through a module on every handler. So there's two ways to doing this. Zeit has a micro framework, which is called Micro, or MIDI. MIDI is specifically built for the AWS cloud. And as I said, that's in the future. We only start looking at it, what's possible, but we have to implement it. So the problem with cold starts, that's really important for the microservices. If the database needs 1 second to warm up, that's terrible, especially if I have one request, or if I have like 20 requests for 20 vector tiles, and they all have to wait. But if in Aurora, the backend is already warm, and it stays while it is active warm, then that's very quick. So there comes the Amazon Notification Service, where there is a topic. In this case, the topic could be it's a vector tile service, and the subscribers are individual handlers, individual microservices for every tile. So every tile fires up this Lambda function, creates the tile if it doesn't exist, or gets it from the cache if it exists. The cache is also in Postgres, and sends it back to the user. As I said, there are other ways. You can also do this in the Google Cloud Engine, and there's a framework called the serverless framework. So the serverless framework is high concept, as in we know how it works. We know we have a backend, we know we have lambdas, and we need to have the lambdas talking. We need to have the microservices talking to each other. So that's the notification service, which might be different called for different cloud providers. So in this case, serverless does that for us, and it writes these serverless YAML files, which just define how the modules and endpoints talk with each other. There's also Zeit Now version 2, which is they use their own builder, and it's not really a version 2, it's completely different to the existing Zeit. And if you follow the development of these builders and how Zeit Now, then you often see that phase in certain forums, because it's fiendishly hard to get working, and they pushed it out, which means since January, you can no longer sign up to Zeit version 1. You have to use version 2. And that's the reason why we say, OK, we're going to look at Amazon AWS. We cannot run the risk that next month they say Zeit version 1 is dead. You got to have to use V2. So we want to have different options open to us. So lastly, I want to talk about the front end. So this is a default dashboard that comes with every deployment. So you go to the root and you see an interface, or you go to a mobile root and you see a mobile interface. So here we have like a map view, a table view, a location view, a list view for locations, a list view for layers. Layers have views as well, which say how should the layer be styled? Can I edit this layer? It works through this control library. So the control library is methods, objects. The biggest objects is the workspace, but also it is it's the layer objects itself, which are augmented. We use a lot object assigned. We use a lot in our code base. And there's everything defined exactly what the format of the layer is. And it's not just defined what the format is, but it's a method. You can just say, get me the layer data, or select the location on this layer. You can create a map view. So if you say, in my deployment, I only really want to have a map, that's the whole code. The whole code is just say, create an instance of XYZ. This is the host. This is the workspace I want to use. And then create a map and put the map on this, this document element. And here I also define then, I use hooks. So in the URL, I have hooks. And I say, OK, if the URL is that, assign these to the template, the document body, or get it directly from the URL and create a view. And there's a couple of other definitions how this map should work. And the same obviously works for a location or a layer. I don't need a map if I just want to see a location. I can just say, get me the location without the map, and I get all the location data. At the moment, we are in the process of changing this whole thing from Leaflet to OpenLayers. Well, it's not so much changing it. We want that OpenLayers or Leaflet or other things all work. The reason why we're doing this, it's OpenLayers is a lot closer to our understandings how layer and locations work. That's why I put layers in parentheses in Leaflet, because you know in Leaflet, every location is a layer. And there is not really this definition of a layer with many locations. Now, we wrote this ourselves, where we say, OK, if the map changes, then remove all the layers on this layer and do an XHR, get the data, create an SVG, and put it on the map. With open layers, that's a lot easier. We just define, OK, this is a layer. Here's the source for the layer, which is the backend. That's the method, so either get it through a cluster or get it as an MVT, and apply these styles, and we add it to the map. If we remove it from the map, it's gone. If we add it again, it's there again. And if the map changes, all these works automatically because the loader knows exactly when should I load data, when shouldn't I load data. Same for the locations. So the leaflet layer as a location has its own events, like I hover over this location, I want to select this location. With open layers, it's a lot nicer because the map, I move the mouse over the map and it finds locations on all layers and highlights them. Well, it only highlights one location, and if I click select, it selects the highlighted location. Okay, I gotta have to speed up a bit. Other objects are filter objects, so that's as we've seen it before, are the standard filters, Boolean match, like, greater than, lesser than, equal, in an array, or knee. Could also be not in an array, but I prefer to call it just the knee filter. Other objects would be style objects, but as we're running out of time, we can't really go into the detail. And as well, it's not really well defined how the styles work on the different render platforms. So lastly, I want to show custom endpoints. So in here is all the resources are on GitHub, and that's the default interface, but it uses the pins, the SVG pins, as static files directly from GitHub. Now with the library, we created a custom interface. This template, the desktop template, is also on the GitHub, and it just put together with filter objects, location views, a map view, a list view, and it's specifically to a client. So in this case, I've written it myself. In the next case, a developer has, a different developer for the client has written it. And we can see the map is a Google map. It uses our backend, but it puts the GeoJSON on a Google map. I don't know why, maybe they like Google. And you can tell I haven't written it because the design, the styling is really nice. So that's also my last slide. And it's very important that I show this slide. Because we're looking for people. Like, I don't really want to do front-end anymore. I want to focus on the middleware. So that's my Twitter handle, and that's the GitHub projects. If you like it, please put a star on it. And if you want to work for us, there's a Bitly link. And important, we want to start interviewing next week. We specifically wanted to wait after Phos4G, put it out. And there's a lot of work to be done. I need to get really started on the microservices. We need to work on the documentation, and importantly, we want that this framework becomes an OSGeo project, and that's also the reason why we're here and showing it, because maybe some of you find it helpful, and I think I gotta have to finish. Is there still time for questions? One question.
Okay, thank you for your talk. One quick question. So people are overwhelmed, for sure. Otherwise, feel free to talk to Dennis in the breaks, or afternoon, or evening. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.